understood, Your Honor. Thank you. Good afternoon, Guadalupe Garcia, on behalf of Mr. Rodriguez-Delgadillo. May it please the court, I would like to reserve 4 minutes of my time for rebuttal.
I'm having a little trouble hearing you distinctly.
As am I.
I apologize. Is this better?
Yeah, that is. Just make sure you're speaking directly towards the directional mic.
Yes, Your Honor. Again, good afternoon, Guadalupe Garcia, on behalf of Mr. Luis Rodriguez-Delgadillo. May it please the court, I would like to reserve 4 minutes of my time for rebuttal.
We'll try to remind you, but also watch the clock yourself.
Yes, Your Honor. There are a few issues raised in this case. The first issue in this matter we would argue is regarding Mr. Rodriguez's removability under.
But I'm sorry to interrupt you.
No problem. Under 8 U.S.C. section 1227A2A, triple small I, which is a legal and constitutional question, which this court may review de novo. This court did in its 2010 holding in Alvarez-Reynada v. Holder find that a conviction under California Penal Code section 496DA.
Why isn't the Flores case controlling on that question?
I'm sorry, Your Honor?
Why isn't the Flores case, a recent one, controlling as to the question that you raised?
On the recent Flores, Your Honor, our position is that there is no set definition for stolen. And our position is that Lopez, the court is referring to Lopez Valencia?
No, to the Flores.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yes, United States versus Flores, 901-3rd.
Yes, I apologize. Our position on the Flores case, if I may have a minute, we would argue that Flores is not controlling in this matter because it deferred to the board's conclusion in Alde Dominguez that receipt of stolen property is a distinct aggravated felony independent of theft and property, and that it need not have been stolen by means of a theft as generically defined. So our position is that the board's interpretation eliminating the requirement that the stolen property in question have been taken by theft renders the statute unconstitutionally vague on that issue.
I think it would be helpful if you went on to the other merits of the case.
Yes, Your Honor. I believe a second issue raised in this matter is should the court find the agency find removability, our second issue we believe is raised is our position is that the board did not base any part of its decision to uphold the immigration judge's denial of withholding under 8 U.S.C. section 1231b3 on a finding that Mr. Rodriguez did not establish a clear likelihood that he would suffer future persecutory harm if he is removed. The entirety of the board's decision in the main context at CAR 4 and 5 with respect to Mr. Rodriguez's withholding claim.
What do you do about footnote 2? Because footnote 2 says, and it's attached to a sentence that says he's not satisfied his burden of proving that his life or freedom will be threatened in Mexico on account of the protected ground. And the footnote says, we also discern no clear error in the immigration judge's findings that the respondent did not establish that he's unlikely to obtain and administer the medicine he needs and as a result will become homeless. Then goes on to say that the second link in the chain of causation about ending up institutionalized also undermines the claim for withholding of removal. It discusses the second one in the context of the torture convention. So how is the footnote not an alternative holding on this point?
Our position is that the footnote in the board's decision does not mean that the board necessarily upheld all aspects of the immigration judge's alternate finding that Mr. Rodriguez is not clearly likely to be persecuted if removed for any reason. Our position
suppose we agreed that the finding that he's unlikely to obtain and that he is likely to obtain an administrative medicines. And in other words, suppose we thought that that was not supported by substantial evidence and therefore he might well become homeless or institutionalized. How does that, that, then what's the link of that to the persecution determination? That's what seems to me, it's discussed in the CAT context, but it's not really discussed in the persecution withholding context. So do we just, if we thought that, would we remand in the withholding to determine whether, how that connected up? I mean, what does it connect up to? That's what I'm trying to understand.
Our position is that should the court, as the court mentioned, find that that would take place, he would become homeless, is that he would also become institutionalized. There are no other options for persons in Mr. Rodriguez-Delgadillo's position.
Then we have this, in the CAT context or the torture context, we have some case law that says, well, even if there's a horrible, miserable institutions, unless somebody's trying to torture him, it doesn't count. I don't know that there's any such law with regard to persecution. So is your point that he might have been persecuted even if he wasn't tortured under those circumstances?
Our position is that there is a potential likelihood that yes, he would be persecuted under these circumstances. And that
being treated, you know, horribly in the institutions, even if not, no one was actually trying to hurt him.
Our position is that they, at this point, the lack of any interference to correct what goes on at the in these institutions in Mexico rises to the level of knowing that this is what takes place, that there the government officials, the government runs these Mexican institutions. They know what takes place in this institution and they do nothing to prevent it. I think the government mentions 1995 laws that were put in place to try and correct what the government knew in 1995 took place in these institutions. Yet over 25 years later, these are still the reports, various articles, various country reports of the torturous conditions that people experience in these institutions. Our position is that regarding the respondent being removed and having the lack of support, the testimony by his mother and even by the respondent indicates that he cannot care for himself. The fact that he goes to the grocery store with his mother who does all of the shopping, does not mean he is able to go shopping. The fact that he accompanies his mother to the pharmacy does not mean that he would be able
to. It's interesting. I mean, the IJ didn't note it, but he testified at the hearing that he'd have nowhere to go and his family wouldn't support him. But at the earlier competency hearing, he was asked, if ICE is successful taking away your residency, what happens next? I will join my uncle in Mexico in Guadalajara. So, you know, isn't that some indication that he does, in fact, have support in Mexico?
Your Honor, he mentions an uncle in Guadalajara whom he has had no contact with. There is no name. He doesn't specifically know where this uncle lives. I think this, his mother who then testifies, I don't believe mentions an uncle. I think she mentions a couple of aunts who they have no contact with and who she testifies would not be in a position to care for him because of their own advanced age position. Does that answer your question, Your Honor?
Well, the question is whether or not there's any reasonable way to read the record and conclude that he did not carry his burden to show that he wouldn't be able, with support from either family in Mexico or in the United States across the border and using Mexican social services, to be able to get his medication. That's the question, is you have to show that there isn't substantial.
I think, Your Honor, based on his testimony and more importantly, his mother's testimony, he doesn't have any family in Mexico who would be able to provide the assistance his family does here. The reason he is not homeless here is because of his parents' support and the fact that they take him to the doctor's appointment. They ensure he takes his medication. His mother testified she has to set out the medication on a daily basis. And he agreed that that's what took place. The fact that I believe it in the immigration judge alluded to, well, his family can send him money. They can send him money, but there is nothing to show he would be able to understand where to collect that money, what to do with that money. Would he be able to pay rent with that money? Would he be able to get himself the medical treatment he needs here? He has various doctors and therapists. Would he be able to again, pay rent, buy his food, and take care of his mental health? Here, if he is having what he calls an illusion, which I believe means he's experiencing delusions, he understands he can voice them to his mother, who can then reach out to the doctor. Prior to him being detained by ICE, he lived with his parents. I believe it was almost 4 years without any negative contact with law enforcement. This was because of his stable medical care and his family support. At his last 2014 arrest, he was in the throes of his disease, such that he was found mentally incompetent to stand trial and was sent to, I believe it was Patton Mental Hospital, where he was stabilized and then returned to deal with this 2014 arrest. This is when his mother testified that she believes was when he was properly diagnosed and placed on the correct medications. Now, to remove him from this stability, it took years to get him on the correct medication, and then to return and lose all of this, we believe would cause him to be placed in institutions or to be subject and or to be subjected to persecution on the street by government officers or police officers. Your Honors, I am running out of time. I would like to reserve my last couple of minutes. If there are no questions.
That's fine. Are there any questions? Hearing none, we'll proceed to Mr. Moss. So, Mr. Moss.
Your Honor, and may it please the court, Benjamin Mark Moss for the respondent, the Attorney General. After a full and fair hearing, Mr. Rodriguez-Delgadillo, who was represented by counsel, was found to have been an aggravated felon based on his conviction for receipt of a stolen vehicle as being an aggravated felony, and was also found to be ineligible for protection from removal. The government asks the court to uphold these conclusions for three reasons. The first relates to Alvarez-Reynaga and the Flores case, both of which bind this panel to conclude that the conviction is in fact an aggravated felony, and both of which upheld the concept that including receipt of stolen property is not unconstitutionally vague, because the proper analysis there is a Chevron reasonableness analysis, which the court has already said it is worthy of that deference. Second, counsel, we ask the court.
Counsel, if he's now not seeking asylum, but seeking withholding of removal and relief under
CAT. Ms. Gould, I can't hear you.
Counsel? Okay, if he's not seeking asylum now, but rather withholding of removal under CAT, then if he can show torture because of lack of medication, wouldn't he be entitled to relief despite those precedents?
Yes, Your Honor. If he could make the necessary showings for either withholding or CAT protection, he would be entitled to protection from removal. And if the court would like,
withholding specifically, what what issues do we have in front of us by virtue of this footnote 2 in the BIA decision? Do we have both pieces of the causal chain on withholding, that I won't use my medication and therefore I'll end up homeless, step one, and then step two, I'll end up homeless and then I'll end up in an institution, and then at the institution I'll suffer mistreatment, which would have to be withholding on a protected ground. Do we have any holding from the BIA on that second part? It's clear we have a holding on the first part, but do we have one on the second? And if we don't, and we find the first one inadequate, would we have to send it back?
Yes, Your Honor. Let me address those questions. As to footnote 2 of the board's decision, the first sentence, and I'm forgive me for looking down and just reading that sentence, we also find, discern no clear error in the immigration judge's findings. The respondent did not establish is unlikely to obtain administered medicine. So that is properly before the court, but for the waiver issue, which we think is an important point to come back to.
No, I don't think there's any waiver here, at least where the exact same issue is discussed. I mean, first of all, it's a little bit ambiguous putting it in the footnote. And they discussed exactly the same issue in the context of the torture convention in their brief, and why we wouldn't consider it for both purposes when it's all there and you're not prejudiced, I'm not quite sure. I see.
Well, Your Honor, the board does say no clear error, which is an indication that is a finding that the board has made with regard to the withholding claim. And that footnote sits on
But it's based on this notion about whether he's unlikely to obtain and administer medicine. And on that, it seems to me the immigration judge's finding is flimsy, and at least quite arguably without substantial evidence, given the fact that there's all kinds of evidence that he has been, doesn't go to the supermarket by himself, can't go to the pharmacy by himself, doesn't know how to get medical care, is always taken by his parents to the doctor. They lay out his medicine every day. He clearly has schizophrenia. There doesn't seem to be any doubt about that. He's hearing voices while he's sitting on the testifying. It seems that the reasons given are fairly flimsy. So assuming that for now, how does that hook up? And what happens next, I think, is what Judge Collins is asking, or at least it's what I'm asking. There doesn't seem to have been any finding or tying in. There was on the CAT claim by saying, well, even if he ends up in an institution, that's still not torture. But I don't know that it's still not persecution. I don't know. I mean, there's no, the causation link there is missing in the board's opinion as to both pieces.
Yes, Your Honor. I would suggest that if the court is inclined to rule that substantial evidence does not support the likelihood of future harm finding, and that issue is properly before the court in the withholding context, then I would suggest that the proper thing to do would be to remand to let the board sort out whatever.
My question is that the likelihood of harm has two components to it. There's actually kind of three components to the withholding claim. And the first two go to the likelihood of harm, and the third goes to whether the harm is on a protected ground. It's a three-step argument. I'm not going to take the medication, and that's the whole, and I'll end up homeless, and that's what's in the first sentence. And then the second is, from being homeless, I'm going to end up in the institution. That's the second step. The third step is then I will have bad things happen at the institution, and for withholding purposes, that would have to be shown to be on a protected ground. I don't see anything in this footnote that covers the third point at all, and it doesn't cross-reference to the torture. The question is the second one here, or does that need to be remanded as well if we don't agree on the first step? Do you understand what I'm focusing on?
I believe I do, Your Honor. And as I read it, it appears that the second one is there because it talked in that footnote second sentence. It refers to the likelihood of becoming institutionalized. But as to the third one, the nexus, the board did not address nexus at all. So if that is an issue that the court believes is necessary to reach, then a remand would...
The particular social group question, which would also have to come in, but your brief comes pretty clear, close to agreeing that the schizophrenia group is probably adequate. And then we have a very recent opinion which seems to say definitively that it's adequate. Let me find the case. Granados versus Garland is pretty close in. So on that ground, the board is probably wrong. Do you think?
Your Honor, I'm not prepared to discuss Granados at this time, given the government's position is that if the court believes it's necessary to reach that second particular social group, we would suggest that a remand is appropriate.
Why should
the government
does that if it's clear from an existing precedent of this court that it's wrong? It's just wrong.
Well, the court should be given, to give the board the opportunity, Your Honor, to address not only the question of whether the evidence in this case shows that there is such a particular social group, but also whether the persecution would indeed be on account of. That's the nexus issue that the board's decision has not addressed.
The second part I understand, the first part I don't understand. All right, let me ask you a global question. Given all this, has the board given any thought to mediating this case? I mean, it seems pretty clear that this guy is going to have a very hard time if he goes back to Mexico. Let's at least put it that way. And I understand that he is was convicted of an aggravated felony, but there are at least explanations about what happened there. Would you be willing to talk with the mediators here?
Yes, Your Honor.
Your agency.
I understand. Very good, Your Honor. Yes, the government is willing to discuss the question with the mediator. I don't mean to suggest any particular outcome is likely, but I would hope I'm not saying too much to say that we're always willing to have the conversation. If I could turn to cat protection, I think that's an important point. There is a requirement that any harm be specifically intended to torture, and that's where the cat claim falls apart here. The record is fairly replete with evidence of unsatisfactory conditions at Mexican mental health institutions, but there just isn't any evidence of is anybody actually intending to torture anyone.
What about this point that at some point when you know this is happening and you're promising to fix it and nothing happens and it's still horrible and abusive and life-threatening, that one intends the results of one's acts?
The case law, Your Honor, does not support that theory. There still needs to be some sort of affirmative intention to torture. And even if that were the rule, that you could sort of infer an intent to torture based on inaction?
If I knew that, and they say something like 10% of the people with schizophrenia in these places commit suicide, and they're in there, they see a thing in their feces, and they're lying on the ground, and they're doing well. And if I'm not the government of Mexico, and I say I'm going to put this person in that circumstance, but I don't mean for him to get hurt, but I'm going to put him in there, and I know he is. And I'm not going to do anything about that. Don't I intend for him to be treated that way? Because that's how he's going to be treated.
Your Honor, it sounds almost like a different mens rea fact pattern where you're suggesting a knowing mens rea as opposed to an intentional one, which is, I would suggest, even higher, and that's what the case law requires, which is actually intention to torture, not even just knowing, as Your Honor's hypothetical suggests, but intention. And let me add one point on cat protection, if I may. There is also a state actor acquiescence issue that the board did not reach because of the issues that it did reach. And so if the court were to find that the board erred or substantial evidence did not support the board's cat protection conclusions, it would not be appropriate to grant cat outright because there is missing an essential analysis concerning acquiescence that the board would have to do. So in that scenario, we would suggest if the court were to identify an error in cat,
the government would be institutions.
I'm sorry, Your Honor, I did not get
I thought the government ran the institutions.
Your Honor, that may be the case, but it's, and I'm not saying that definitely is the case. I also remember having seen record evidence in there, but what I'm trying to suggest is that the role of who says that and who makes that conclusion needs to be the agency in the first instance under the ordinary remand rule.
It's essential. Is there any parallel case law in the persecution context that you know of?
As I argue here today, Your Honor, I'm not aware of similar case law with a specific intent. The definition of persecution is a different definition. And we haven't actually briefed that comparison. If the court believes that issue is necessary to reach, I'd be happy to file something.
Counsel, should the government be held to intend the natural and probable consequences of their actions?
Well, Your Honor, if that is, let me answer it this way, Your Honor. Some of the evidence shows that the Mexican government did in fact moderately increase the funding for treatment of mental health. And in that sense, it would be appropriate to conclude that the Mexican government has not shown a specific intent to torture. But I'm not able to say that the Mexican government's actions with respect to treatment of people who have mental issues, I'm not able to say today that there is an intent to specific intent to torture. The record does not compel that finding.
Okay, thank you.
As I see that my time is nearing its end, I would ask the court to uphold the board's decision. And unless the court has any further questions, we would submit. Thank you, Your Honor.
Okay, I have no questions. Mr. Collins, Judge Prezan, no questions. Give over. Return to Ms. Garcia for rebuttal argument.
Thank you, Your Honor. We would again reiterate, Your Honor, that every part of the immigration immigration judge's finding, which the board relied upon regarding a lack of clear likelihood of torture, was purely speculative. We would agree with the court that it was purely speculative, as the testimony and the record only allows for the possibility that should Mr. Rodriguez-Delgadillo be returned, he will not have any meaningful kind of support in Mexico, and that left untreated, his schizophrenia could lead to him being homeless. Unfortunately, probability of engaging in criminal behavior because of the delusions that would cause, which would subject him to being arrested by the police, being subjected to being placed in the mental institutions. And our position continues to be that the government is an agent that knows and acquiesces to the treatment of people who are detained in these mental institutions. This isn't recent. This has been going on for, just based on the government's mention of 1994 changes in law that were supposed to take place to better the institutions and that have not. There's a lot of evidence regarding in articles and the country report that the continual torture of people in these mental institutions, and the government is aware that this takes place and does nothing, and I would argue it's complicit.
Can I ask you, as I asked the government, whether you would be willing to and think it's a good idea to engage in, or at least to talk about whether you should mediate this case?
Your Honor, we would agree. I'm reviewing the case at the last minute, did reach out to Mr. Moss to see if we could discuss any maybe alternate resolutions. He did seem that he would be open to this, and we would be open to it also.
You say you have already reached out to him, is that what you said?
We did, but it was after my review during the weekend. It was very last minute. He was not able to, I did not allow him the time to look into it properly.
Okay, thank you very much.
If there are no further questions, I will submit, Your Honor. Thank you.
Thank you. So Rodriguez-Delgadillo shall now be submitted. And the parties will hear from us soon if we have a mediation order, and the parties will hear from us, and of course if we don't order mediation.
Thank you, Ron. Thank you. Have a good afternoon.
Thank you both, and again we appreciate your argument during this pandemic period. It's very helpful to us.
Thank you. Thank you, counsel.
Thank you.